And then everything unraveled. You know, you say, okay, we have the red center, we have the red planet.
Hello, and welcome back to Curiosity Mine. Let's go somewhere a little bit more interesting. There we go, that's far more appropriate for this video. So, this is the opal mining town of Lightning Ridge in Outback Australia with its unique and otherworldly landscape. It's been described as looking a bit like the moon with all of the mine diggings and heaps of discarded moloch or opal dirt in the wake of opal miners, but research suggests that this landscape has more in common with our red planetary neighbour, Mars.
I am here in Australia because of opal.
This is Dr. Patrice Rey, a geologist with the University of Sydney who has studied the similarities between Outback Australia and the surface of Mars, and he's drawn some really remarkable conclusions about what this environment can tell us about Mars, and vice versa. I met up with Dr. Rey, who took us on a virtual reality tour of Jezero Crater on Mars, the landing site of the Perseverance Rover, and showed us firsthand, or at least virtually firsthand, the location on Mars where rocks were identified as hosting opaline silica.
Yeah, so that world is dedicated to Mars 2020 mission, the objective of which is to try to find molecular evidence for early life on Mars. And at the moment we have the rover Perseverance, who is roaming in the G0 crater, collecting rocks, so drilling piece of rocks that will be collected in 10 to 15 years time and return it to Earth for further analysis. And there is a sound on the background that you probably don't hear. You hear it when you are in that virtual world. And the sound is the wind that has been recorded. The sound of the wind on Mars. This is the rumble that we have. Again, you can listen to those recording on the NASA website. So the G0 crater is located in the north hemisphere, about 20 degrees above the equator. And that site was selected because it shows the presence of a river delta. So that's the trace of this ancient delta, showing a river flowing into that impact crater. And that little wiggle here, that little white line, is the path that Perseverance has been following over the past year and a half now. So altogether, Perseverance has made about 20 kilometers from its landing spot. So the landing spot was somewhere over here. And then he moved to the south, did a little loop, come back and all around. And a few days ago, he reached that spot here. And those red marks are places where samples have been drilled and dropped to be collected in one of the next Mars mission. So Perseverance is right here. We have a little 3D model of that rover. He has the size of a small car.
So let's have a quick look at Perseverance, because it's a pretty impressive little vehicle. And as I say that, that's one of the biggest misconceptions about the Mars rovers that we can dispel here. They're not little vehicles at all. Perseverance is 2.9 meters long, 2.7 meters wide, and 2.2 meters tall. So it's probably quite a bit bigger than you imagine. We'll come back to the Perseverance rover in future videos, so stay tuned. There's a really cool story coming up about some of the technology on this thing and its relationship with Outback Australia too.
So on those rocks, this is where, you know, opaline silica has been described. Rocks that are similar in composition. Opaline silica and a lot of iron oxide that give that rusty color to Mars, which is so close to the rusty color of Central Australia. And of course, there is a good reason why this red color exists. It's due to the oxidation of the rocks at the surface of Mars. And the same oxidation process did occur in Central Australia. And it turns out that the rocks at the surface of Mars derive from the erosion of basalt. Basically, we have sandstone. So all those layers here are made of layer of sandstones. Not the sandstone rich in quartz, but the sandstone rich in feldspar, which is one of the prime mineral that makes 50-60% of basalt. And it is the weathering of this feldspar that give the clay. And of course, the basalt is a rock which is very rich in iron. So the iron will give you this red color when it is oxidized. So similar type of sandstone on Mars and in Central Australia, similar oxidation history, and therefore similar mineralogy. The clay, the iron oxide, and also the opaline silica, they all have been described on Mars and in Central Australia.
Professor Rey found himself in Lightning Ridge in the early 2000s.
In 2003, when I received a phone call, so Maxine O'Brien gave a call to the School of Geosciences. She ended up talking to the secretary, you know, say, oh, who can talk to you here? And I ended up having, you know, that phone call, you know. And Maxine, I remember, Maxine talked to me about Opal and Lightning Ridge. And to me, Opal was Cobra Pedy. So my first question to Maxine, sorry, you know, I'm relatively new in Australia, okay? With respect to Cobra Pedy, where is Lightning Ridge? And she said, no, you know, we are here in New South Wales. We, you know, 8 hours drive from Sydney. I said, oh, we find also Opal there. I thought it was only, you know, Cobra Pedy. No, we find Opal in many places. That's how I end up, you know, doing my first trip, you know, in Lightning Ridge, connecting with that community. In fact, I do remember my very first rock. They were talking about the steel band. Oh, you know, Patrice, we are looking for the steel band, and usually we find opal underneath, you know. But the steel band is a good thing. I say, well, I want to see the steel band.
Steel band is a specific layer of sandstone that's much harder than most Lightning Ridge sandstone that often contains dark greyish chunks of material. A while ago, I visited a working mine with opal miner Shaun Galman, and we had a good look at some steel band near the roof of his mine.
So another commonality we see in claims, now and again, not all that often. It's once you get away from the older fields in Lightning Ridge, it gets a bit sparse here and there, but that is something we term steel band. And it basically is this silicified material on the roof. So if I tap it here, you can... you can hear, we call it steel band for a reason, and you can see the difference immediately between it and the surrounding sandstones. Generally, when it forms like this, it's usually a precursor to knobbies, as the silica is pooled, and that will generally go on to become knobbies in an area. Not so much in a claim like this, but this can form in big sheets. And in areas like the old 3 Mile, it was between a millimetre and 200 mils thick in places and full of colour. And you can get quite beautiful opal in and around steel band. It's something the old timers always used to look for in the day, just because of the silica content. So it just shows the claim is silica rich. Do you want me to dig it out? I can pull it out if you like.
If you want to.
All right, let's have a look at this piece. There we go. So that's a strange indication there, because that tells me that's almost water-worn. It almost looks like a water-worn river rock, which is quite unusual considering this steel band is normally in large sheets. We'll take this one out too here. And this one itself just looks like that formation, but not quite as unique as the other. But you can see it's containing a bit of matrix here, and it probably has a little bit of potch through all the silicified minerals and bits and pieces. But again, very, very tough stuff. Generally, when we hit this stuff with a jackhammer, the point will just stop on it and start to smoke. You'll get the odd spark now and again, and hence the name steel band.
And I remember taking a piece of steel band, and I take my little lenses, and I look around and I see sparkles of green and blue. And I said to the guy, well, this steel band is a sandstone, is your matrix opal, it's full of opal, you know. And I remember there was a few, Bob Barrett was there, started to laugh about, oh, look at that French guy, he sees opal now everywhere. He takes a rock, he finds opal. And I said, yeah, there is opal in all that, that steel band is strong because it's complete sealed with silica, you know. So yeah, I came back thinking, oh, there was interesting things, you know, to understand. It's not random. There is features that we can study. You know, the steep band to me is clearly something that we need to pay attention to.
Curiosity Mine is now on Patreon. Patreon is a service that allows you to directly support your favorite creators to allow them to continue making the content that you love. If you enjoy these videos and you think Curiosity Mine deserves your support, head on over to patreon.com/curiositymine for more information on how you can support the channel directly. If you do, you'll get your name on this list of awesome people who are supporting the channel already. So head on over to patreon.com/curiositymine or curiositymine.com/patreon. All roads lead to Rome. But for now, all roads lead back to Jezero Crater on Mars. So from there, Dr. Rey found himself involved in an ongoing project to understand the formation of Australian Opal, which is quite a colossal task.
So in 2003, when I get my first contact with the Opal Miner Association in Lightning Ridge, my comment I made to Maxine was, oh, I'm happy to, you know, drive to Lightning Ridge and have a look around, but, you know, I know nothing about sedimentary rocks, I know nothing about weathering, I don't know nothing about sandstone, you know, I go to the Pilbara, I look at all rocks, deep rocks, I'm not too sure I'm the guy that may help you understand that surface geology there. But anyway, I was happy to go there and have a look, and when I came back to Sydney, I thought, oh, this is very interesting, you know, I know nothing about the thing, but I can clearly see it's not random. We should be able to help those guys, you know. And it's a bit embarrassing that we are entering the 2000s, you know, it was 2003. We have been mining opal for the past 150 years. We still don't know how it forms. This is a bit embarrassing. You know, I felt I was embarrassing. At the same time, I felt I was completely inadequate. You know, I was not able to help. And I tried to figure out, you know, my sedimentary colleagues around, but none of them were really receptive of the idea of walking into a problem where we know nothing, you know. But to me, it was very exciting too. It's not every day that you have a problem that nobody has done almost any work on. So from 2003, I started to pay attention to anything dealing with opal, you know, volcanic opal, sedimentary opal, fossilized opal, mud cracks, you know, I was reading, trying to understand weathering. It took me a good 5-6 years to understand enough of the surface processes to believe that, oh, I think we can crack that.
When Dr. Rey refers to weathering here, he's talking about weathering in the geological sense, which basically means the breaking down of rocks by environmental factors such as water, acid, salts, things like that. When rocks break down, they can be separated into their component chemicals or their component chemical compounds, which are then able to interact with the environment and with other rocks to form new minerals over time. Opal is a great example of this, as the formation of opal is triggered by the weathering of minerals in the existing rocks.
And of course, at the time, I was reading everything I could about opal, and one day I found an article describing opaline silica on Mars. 2008, NASA say, hey, we find, you know, this interesting mineral. And that's interesting because opaline silica is made of silica, but it's made also 5, 10, 15% of water.
Opal, as we know it on Earth, is hydrated amorphous silicon dioxide. Silicon dioxide is also known as silica, which is a form of ceramic. Amorphous means that the mineraloid does not form in a crystalline structure, and hydrated means that it contains water, or it has water, hydrogen and oxygen, chemically bonded into it.
And to me, I thought, oh, this is really interesting, because we talk about volcanic opal, and we talk about sedimentary opal, but I know the sediment now derive from volcanic rocks. So the volcanic opal and the sedimentary opal, to me, that's the same. It's the same matrix. But then you're telling me that on Mars you find opaline silica, and I know nothing about Mars except that the crust of Mars is made of basaltic rocks, volcanic rocks. And I thought, okay, now this is the third time I can associate opal with volcanic rocks. We have opal with volcanoes, we have opal in Central Australia, Hindu sandstone derived from volcanic rocks, and now on Mars we have silica coming from a volcanic basaltic crust. Okay, how do you do that? So I started to read, you know, the literature on Mars, and people were really mapping all the clay, opal in silica, all those funny mineralogy. And I was looking at those mineralogy and I start to say, okay, yes, I have that. We have opal in silica in Central Australia. Oh yeah, we have, you know, kaolinite. Yeah, we have kaolinite. Barite. Oh yeah, no, yeah, we have barite. Gypsum, plenty of gypsum. Teak, jarosite. And jarosite is a mineral that signs super high high acidity. So jarosite, you know, alunite, even gypsum, there are minerals that you find in environment where the weathering is under, you know, hyper acidic condition, very acidic condition. So I thought, okay, well, if on Mars, you know, sulfuric acid again drive the weathering, and they knew, the people from NASA, and they knew that the sulfuric acid came from the oxidation of volcanic gases. So all those volcanoes on Mars release sulfur dioxide, and it is the interaction of this gas with photons that produce sulfuric acid. So they knew that the atmosphere of Mars was made of a fog of sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid, basalt, weathering, okay, clay, and amorphous silica, great. And you see that at that stage, I thought, okay. Where could the acidity come in the Great Artesian Basin? And I started to read about acidic, you know, weathering, and then I start to see pyrite. Oh yeah, you know, around mine we have pyrite, and we have this acidic soil in estuaries. That's because of the pyrite. And I thought, okay, well, do we have pyrite in our sediment? So I started to look at logs, you know, people, you know, drilling and describing the mineralogy underneath the weathering, you know. And everywhere, all the report, they were talking about disseminated pyrite. So pyrite was everywhere. Underneath that layer that has been completely weathered, you preserve a fresh sediment away from the oxygen where the pyrite is still stable. And everywhere I could see pyrite everywhere in those things. So basically it is by understanding how opaline silica were formed on Mars that I could, you know, find the final puzzle, piece of the puzzles in the Great Artesian Basin. And then everything unraveled. You know, you say, okay, we have the red center, we have the red planet. All right, how much, you know, analog you want? We have the same sediment, you know, volcanic clastic sediment in Great Artesian Basin, volcanic clastic sediment on Mars. On Mars, they talk about the dry out of the surface that drive that oxidation. Central Australia was the same. It was flooded, drying out, and oxidation. So I could see all those parallels. So when I wrote that paper, you know, writing the story of the Great Artesian Basin, I mentioned that, okay, that story is a story that we know also on Mars. Now, if you want to say, hey, is there any precious opal on Mars? I would say chances are really high, you know, but again, keep in mind that 99% of this opal is still poached opal. So you still need to be lucky to find, you know, precious opal on Mars.
So there's a good reason that the landscape of Outback Australia looks like Mars, because it's very, very geologically similar. It's a very convenient analogue right here on Earth for the surface of our nearest and maybe most potentially habitable neighbour. And it would also seem very likely that other connections could be drawn from this research based on observations of chemical and geological phenomena in this environment that may also apply on Mars. This is really cool stuff. I also had a chat with Dr. Rey about the Great Artesian Basin and another amazing contribution that he made to the Perseverance 2020 mission. So stay tuned for both of those videos coming very soon on Curiosity Mine. This video was made with the help of Dr. Patrice Rey, who was kind enough to give me an afternoon of his time to have some amazing discussions about other planets, VR technology, and of course, Martian opal. If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing to Curiosity Mine on YouTube and maybe even supporting the channel on Patreon. The link is in the description. And thank you for watching.